Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the Presentation of Colors by Oklahoma State University ROTC and for the singing of our national anthem by Cindy Scarberry from the Oklahoma Opry.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the
welcome to the Western Heritage Awards, live from the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum in Oklahoma City. Selling more than 38 million copies with 32 number one hit singles and over 80 million spins on radio, he's been honored by the Nashville Songwriters Association International with its Songwriter Artist of the Decade distinction. He's a three-time BMI Country Songwriter Artist of the Year, and most recently was awarded the Career Achievement Award by the Academy of Country Music. His current CD, Drinks After Work, is available now. And his new Shut Up and Hold On tour, presented by Ford F-Series, unleashes May 25th. Please welcome your host, singer, songwriter, and superstar, Toby Keith.
Thank you. I probably got some friends here. Good evening. It's such an honor to be here tonight amongst others who share a love and support of Western heritage. Tonight we'll connect with talented individuals who are passionate about preserving, sharing, and honoring the ideals and values of the great American West. It is through the respected words, images, roles, songs, and distinguished gifts that we recognize them for many contributions and achievements. First presented in 1961, the museum's Western Heritage Awards honor the legacies of great men and women, recognize those whose works reflect the significant stories of the American West. Much like the Academy Awards has the Oscar, the Western Heritage Awards are symbolized by the Wrangler. The most recent version of this revered trophy was created by Oklahoma artist Harold Holden, who joins us here tonight. Let's give him a round of applause. And assisting with the presentation of Wrangler Awards is Miss Rodeo Oklahoma 2014, Lauren Heaton, and Miss Rodeo Oklahoma Teen, Lauren Elise Wade. This event is possible because of the generous support of our event sponsors and partners displayed on the screens this evening. And a special thank you to our presenting sponsor this evening, American Energy Partners. Now let's meet our first extraordinary individual to be inducted into the Hall of Great Westerners. Presenting the award is 8-time Wrangler Award winner and inductee into the Hall of Great Westerners, my friend, Red Stegall.
Thank you, Toby. I'm honored to be here tonight among friends to celebrate the achievements and contributions of a genuine cowboy, a businessman, and a Westerner. He's an active leader in preserving and protecting the West. I'm proud to say that I know him pretty well. And if I were to ask an artist, any artist, to draw a picture of a perfect gentleman, they'd draw a picture of Robert Norris. He's a philanthropist. He's always ready to aid wherever he can. And he makes contributions both with his time and resources and his talents to people who really need the help. Those who, we like to say in the West, need a leg up. I want you to take a look at our first inductee in the Hall of Great Westerners. I'm proud to say that this gentleman is my friend, and I consider that one of my life's greatest treasures. Tonight, this event is sponsored by Love's Travel Shops and Country Stores. Would you join me as we watch the video?
One thing you can definitely say about Robert Norris is that he's a real cowboy. He grew up on his family's farm in St. Charles, Illinois. After studying animal husbandry at the University of Kentucky, he became the manager of the family business. Several years later, Norris decided that farming was not right for him anymore, so he and his wife Jane took off for the West. He moved to the Colorado Springs area, started buying ranch land, and now has the oldest registered brand in Colorado. Today, T-Cross Ranches have more than 120,000 acres. Through Norris's leadership, the T-Cross brand has become well known for producing some of the best working ranch horses in the nation and has been nominated for the prestigious AQHA Best Remuda Award. He also received the AQHA Legacy Award for breeding and registering foal 50 years in a row. In the early 1960s, an advertising executive from Chicago leased part of the ranch as a location for a commercial for the Marlboro brand cigarettes. They brought along a model to play a cowboy for the photo shoot, but quickly realized he did not look like a real cowboy. The ad man hired Norris on the spot, making him the first Marlboro man. Norris continued with Marlboro for the next 12 years. He has served on the board of directors for many of the most well-known rodeo and equine organizations in the country, including the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum. In 1996, he was inducted into the American Quarter Horse Hall of Fame after previously serving on the board of directors and as president. His business savviness, entrepreneurial spirit, and philanthropic mindset run generations deep. Robert Norris has been an advocate of Western heritage and truly embodies the cowboy spirit and the ideals of a great Westerner.
As he makes his way to the stage, would you folks join me as we induct my friend and the real cowboy into the Hall of Great Westerners? His name, Robert Norris.
Thank you.
Well, I'll tell you what. This teleprompter is something new. But I read my speech to Bobby this afternoon, and he said it sounded great. He said, now we need to cut 58 minutes off down to 3 minutes. He made me promise not to even mention the word elephant, or the lights go out immediately. Well, I guess he didn't mean it. But anyway, first and foremost, by my wife, Jane, who's unable to be here this evening. In 1994 was the first day we met. And I told her I would marry her on August, I wasn't going to do this, 10th, 1950. That was my first fork in the road as I was getting out on my own. I have also been blessed with a wonderful family. And the fact I've been able to live out my dreams of becoming a rancher and taking a different road, forks in the road through life. I've come to many forks in the road in my life, and I'm blessed to have chosen the right time, right road, most of the time. Thank you, Yogi Berra. In 42 years on the board of this great museum, I've had the opportunity to meet some and made friends with some of the brightest and most talented people in the world. But most of all, it's what the museum stands for: honor and integrity. What this country needs more of today. The Western Heritage Awards promotes this theme. Bill Nebecker did a bronze called The Measure of a Man. It came out with about 2 years ago. The minute I saw that, I said I had to have a copy of that bronze. It shows a cowboy standing there, holding out his hand. He said, make a deal. And you knew that his word was bond, a bond. A little bronze, which actually nails what this museum stands for. In closing, I'd like to thank the board of directors for this honor, all the hardworking staff of the museum who keep it running year round, and all of you for being here tonight, and every member of this great museum. God bless. It's been a beautiful trip.
Here to present the Western Heritage Awards in our music category, please welcome singer-songwriters and Wrangler Award winners Junie Fisher and Michael Martin Murphy.
Presenting the award for Outstanding Original Western Composition, sponsored by Liz and Paul Loki.
Through the song, our artist pays tribute to her mother, who was once a one-room schoolhouse teacher on the prairie, farmer's wife for 60 years, a cowgirl, a 4-H leader, and long-standing community volunteer. She's proud of her humble beginnings, gives you a glimpse of the difference her mother has made.
Through her thought-provoking lyrics, she encourages us to think about the influences of our mothers have had on us. Her 13th album, Portrait of a Cowgirl, captures her best qualities as a songwriter and vocalist with its collective themes of Western lifestyle, rural sensibility, and prairie passion.
Our award tonight for Outstanding Original Western Music Composition, Portrait of a Cowgirl, is for Eli Barcy.
On a cold winter morning, the first day of the year, a baby girl was born in...
Well, hi, everybody. I feel so blessed and thankful to be up here tonight. What a great honor. I feel blessed because I know where my talents come from, and I'm so thankful every day that God guides me to use them to honor him. I wrote this song, Portrait of a Cowgirl, for my mom, Georgina, who at 85 years old is still the epitome of a true cowgirl, strong and patient and loving. So I'll be sharing this award with her for sure. I want to thank my best friend and husband, John Cunningham, for the never-ending love and support. My friend, Gary Bright, from RPS Entertainment Group, for submitting my song. And my co-producer, Bart McKay, up in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. And a huge thank you going out to all the good folks here at the museum and the decision makers and my sponsors, Paul and Linda Loki, and for this great honor. Once again, thank you. I hope you all have a wonderful night. And thanks again. God bless.
This year's outstanding traditional Western music album continues to build a legacy that enriches our vision of the American West. In tales of the day-to-day lives and emotions of those who have lived it, this Grammy-nominated singer, guitarist, keeps alive the sights, the sounds, and feelings of the West and does it better than anybody else I know.
Amen. The album features 17 songs, including When I Was a Cowboy, Cattle Call, and Riders in the Sky. 6-time Wrangler Award winner and a Chester A. Reynolds honoree, he continues to be a beacon of cowboy music in America. Sponsored by Boo Harris, congratulations to our outstanding traditional Western music album winner for Just Me and My Guitar, my hero, Don Edwards.
Steamboat, no fancy Pullman train. I rode many a cattle trail, I've slept out in the rain. I've rode through blinding hailstorms, I've heard the wild wind moan. I'll tell you, I ain't never heard nothing like that mean cyclone.
Thank you. This is amazing to me. That's to win the Wrangler Award is just an amazing thing. I mean, it's just what everything this museum represents is what I've been all about my entire life. And met so many wonderful people and through the music and things like that. But I want to thank the judges, and I want to thank this wonderful National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum, with all the wonderful people I've been around. And I revere your friendship, and everybody in this room, I think, knows that this is a very special place, and I am so proud of that. I'm so blessed, and I should thank God for giving me the opportunity to do what I do, and I can't express that in words. I'd like to also thank my wonderful wife, Kathy, of 38 years, and for being so supportive of what I do, and we work together, and being the love of my life, and I really appreciate all the wonderful things that have come about and been here at this wonderful museum, and I just want to say thanks, and God bless you, and God bless America. Thank you.
I never rode no steamboat, no fancy Pullman train. I rode many a cattle trail, I slept out in the rain.
Michael, look at all the people here. I think the tickets sold like wildfire.
Actually, that's a dirty word in the West right now, wildfire.
It certainly is.
Tell you the truth, I think the Methodists aren't using any water at all, and the Baptists are sprinkling when they baptize.
Well, our final Wrangler in the music category goes to the New Horizons Award winner for a recording artist or band in the first 5 years of their career. We recognize a young lady who's inspired by the wonderful music and talent from the early 20s through the late 50s as she fell in love with Gene Autry, Roy Rogers, Cyndi Walker, and Bob Wills.
I spent some time with her and her family today, and she has this ability to interpret her own tunes as well as those of others. She's a songwriter, wrote 7 out of the songs on her album, by the way, and her incredible songwriting is really authentic. It's said she represents a great hope of the future of Western music. At 17, I'd say that's a pretty excitement statement. She's the youngest to ever receive a Wrangler Award.
Yeah.
Congratulations to our New Horizons Western Award Heritage winner for her album, Gotta Be a Cowgirl, Mickey Daniel, and her producer from Muscado Productions, Marvin Odell.
I want a hand-carved belt and a silver buckle set and a Palomino pony to ride. A Stetson sombrero with 5X's in the
back. Wow, well, thank you, National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum, for this incredible honor. Thank you, Marvy, for producing my album. He believed in me and my songwriting, and he really made this album possible. Thanks to my parents, because they're awesome, and because they have always supported me with their unconditional love and finances. Y'all are my inspiration. Thanks to my engineer, Brian Cuban, and to the Red Hot Rhythm Rustlers for being my band and my backup. It really is true. With God, all things are possible.
I want a hand-carved belt and a silver buckle set and a Palomino pony to ride. A Stetson sombrero with 5X's in the band and a pair of Shipley spurs.
Congratulations to our 3 Wrangler recipients in the music category. I'm often inspired by other artists, and it's exciting to see Western heritage being preserved and expressed through such songs. Next, we honor another great Westerner presenting this award, sponsored by Express Ranches, as a member of the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum's Board of Directors, J.K. Norfleet.
Our next inductee is a dear personal friend, John K. Jack Goodman, has made his mark in the Western art world, the thoroughbred racing world, the business world, and hell, he still had time to be the best horseman I ever saw, and tough as a pine knot. You know, I could stand here all night and tell Jack Goodman stories. All of them would be true, but you probably wouldn't believe half of them. So let's take a look at the legacy of this great Westerner.
Businessman, writer, racehorse owner, horseback rider, cattleman, and avid polo player, Tucson, Arizona native John K. Jack Goodman leaves his imprint on the Great West. More so, the West has left its mark on this great Westerner. In 1937, Goodman was admitted to the Evans Ranch School, a preparatory institute for boys outside of Tucson. He was enamored with the West and Western art, and on a student's allowance, acquired his first reproductions of Western art, which has since sparked a lifetime of fascination. He went on to graduate from the Wharton School of Finance and Yale University before serving in the Army Air Force during World War II. Following the war, he returned home to Arizona to focus on family real estate and ranching enterprises. Inspired by Arizona's colorful Western history and to spur the public's interest in Western art, Goodman and 4 like-minded friends established the Mountain Oyster Club, a private club dedicated to collecting and displaying Western art and maintaining Western traditions. He was awarded a Wrangler in Best Western Art Book in 1978 for his book, Ross Steffen, Contemporary Painter of the Southwest. He's been a member of the Board of Directors of the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum since 1989, now Director Emeritus. He was also one of the founders of the Los Chatos del Desierto annual horseback ride in Arizona. His competitive nature is apparent, being the national lightweight boxing champion at Yale to winning the Grand National Steeplechase of Aintree, England in 1964. For his devotion to the West, encouraging aspiring artists, and cultivating the public's interest in Western heritage and art, Jack Goodman is inducted into the Hall of Great Westerners.
Directors for this great honor, and particularly to my friend J.K. Norfleet. This proves one thing, and that is a blind hog occasionally picks up an acorn. The West has been my life ever since I left Missouri for Tucson at the age of 17. The West I knew then has changed, but I've ridden along with that history. At 93, know that I have had some amazing and wonderful experiences. They are all topped by the one of standing before you tonight to be inducted into this revered company of great Westerners. Without the love and support and blessing of all my family and friends, many of whom are here this evening, I wouldn't be here to thank you all. God bless you.
Here to present the Western Heritage Awards in our next four literary categories, please welcome Olympic gold medalist and stuntman Dean Smith and John Wayne's granddaughter, Anita LaCava Swift.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for having us back again this year.
Well, now, Anita, you know, I've known you since you were in Rompers, and that's been quite a while ago, but I want you to know it's really an honor to be able to present these awards with you and to see you grown up like you have.
Thank you, Dean. Okay.
So, storytelling is something shared in every culture as a means of entertainment, education, preservation, and the instilling of moral values.
Many of us remember the popular stories that our grandparents and great-grandparents have passed down in the hopes that we would continue to share their stories with future generations. In words, we can capture their legacy.
Our first literary award recognizes the outstanding juvenile book in the collections of bilingual stories about the Rio Huerco Valley. He shares the traditions, myths, and stories of his homeland.
He recounts stories of the evil eye and rooster racing, the wailing woman, and the punishing of the Santos. Preceding each tale, the author provides us with an explanation of the history and culture behind the story. Congratulations to our outstanding juvenile book, sponsored by Ellen Vick, Grandma Santo on Its Head, Stories of Days Gone by author Dr. Nazario Garcia, accepting the award from the University of New Mexico Press is Lauren Consuelo Tusing.
Garcia sends his deepest regrets for not being able to attend this evening. He wanted me to share that the Wrangler Award is very special to him. The design of the award reminds him of the times he shared riding horses with his grandfather and father. He's honored and humbled to receive the Wrangler Award. Thank you.
Next, we recognize the outstanding Western novel by Philip Meyer. The acclaimed author of American Rust returns with an epic of the American West and the multi-generational saga of power, blood, land, and oil that follows the rise of one unforgettable Texas family.
From the Comanche raids of the 1800s to the oil booms of the 20th century, the masterwork is harrowing, panoramic, and deeply evocative. The author said, "I wanted to think about our creation myth. You know, what is the fundamental story that defines America? And it certainly is the West."
The Sun by Philip Meyer makes a viable claim to be a great American novel and is a masterpiece of American fiction while he is not here tonight. He is recognized as the year's outstanding Western novel.
This year's outstanding nonfiction book provides us with a thoughtful examination of a century of travel writing about the American West.
Travel writers found a respectful audience for their reports on history, geography, and the natural world. This book demonstrates the general genre importance and understanding of the American West.
This book is a testament to the instructive ways in which the best travel writers have represented the West, and a tribute to the overlooked authors whose lively perspectives of our history deserve new attention.
The Western Heritage Award for Outstanding Nonfiction Book is sponsored by the Oklahoma Ford Dealers.
It goes to Global West, American Frontier, Travel, Empire, and Exceptionalism, From Manifest Destiny to the Great Depression, by author David Robel and Lauren Consuelo Tusing, from the University of New Mexico Press.
Thank you. Well, as Henry VIII said to each of his new wives, I won't be keeping you long. And it won't take you long to realize that I'm not originally from around here. I am from the Southwest, though, Southwest London, and I'm very proud to be accepting this award for my work about the American West. Thank you to the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum, to my publisher, the University of New Mexico Press, my employer, the University of Oklahoma, and my deepest debt of gratitude by far is to my wonderful wife and much better half, Janet. Janet, thank you for keeping me so long, and thank you all for making the two of us feel so welcome and at home in the West.
And here to make the induction into the Hall of Great Westerners is retired CEO of the Omaha World Herald, former national president of Boy Scouts of America, and former chairman of the World USO Board, John Gottschalk.
You know, next we want to meet a friend of mine, a fellow Nebraskan whose service to our country spans over 40 years. He exemplifies the Western ideals of honesty, integrity, leadership, and self-sufficiency. Tonight, I'm standing in for Secretary of Defense Chuck Hagel, who, along with General Brown and me, grew up in the Sandhills ranch country of Nebraska. Secretary Hagel asked me to relay his message along with my own. Charlie came from a proud pioneer stock to the folks that settled the Nebraska territories. And he loved to share that. But he was much more. He was a decorated Vietnam veteran. He was a rodeo champion, calf roping even into his 60th year. He was a Middle East peace negotiator. And most of all, he was a man of integrity and honor and loyalty. We're blessed to be his friend, and it is fitting that he's being recognized in this very special way. Let's meet the Cowboy General.
U.S. Army Lieutenant General Charles W. Brown was deemed a Cowboy General by the editors of Stars and Stripes newspaper. Graduating from high school at age 15, he worked on the family ranch in Nebraska until 1 year later, when he was accepted to New Mexico Military Institute. He graduated in 1953 at age 20, still too young to receive his regular Army commission until he turned 21. This experience became the second greatest influence upon his life after the ranch. He always said he would stay in the Army until something better came along. He was deployed to serve his country in Korea, Germany, France, and Vietnam as he was promoted through the ranks to Lieutenant General. Throughout his nearly 40-year military career, it was his deep desire to reunite his family ranch under a single owner to avoid it ever being divided. Upon retirement from the Army in 1990, he took over management of the Brown Brothers Ranch in the sand hills of western Nebraska and began rebuilding the reputation of the ranch his father and uncle had constructed. He managed to return the herd to 99% Black Angus. Now the ranch belongs to his son, Stephen, and to be followed by his son, Austin, preserving the Brown Brothers Ranch name and legacy for the next 100 years. It was said that Charles was equally comfortable with cowboys or kings, but riding rodeo with his troops in Germany, he preferred the cowboys to the kings. Inducted into the Hall of Great Westerners, the late Lieutenant General Charles W. Brown, we salute your unwavering service to this country and for your contributions to the West.
Sponsored by Linda and Ronald Boucher, please join me in inducting to the Cowboy General into Western Hall of Fame. Accepting the award is his wife, Sherry Brown, his son, Stephen, and his daughter, Christy Stewart Brown.
Thank you, John. You know, I can tell you, out of all the accomplishments in my father's life, and as you saw, there were many, he would have viewed this honor as the greatest achievement in his life. He would never have believed that he would be inducted in this manner. But I'm going to tell you two brief stories that sum up Charlie Brown, most of whom you didn't know. After being in the military a few years, he came home one day with an idea to run his family ranch. Unfortunately, when he told his parents, "I'm ready to take over," they said, "Well, we aren't ready to give it up yet." He never told me so, but I think that broke his heart. So without any other plan, he went back to the Army, which turned out okay. But when he retired, he came home to his beloved ranch to be a cattleman, and he was a cattleman to the end of his days. And the second story is about what happens when you put a cowboy in charge of arms negotiations. You know, when Charlie was the chief gunrunner for the United States Department of Defense, he was negotiating with an Arab prince. He was selling him 50 tanks at what Charlie considered to be a very bargain basement price. To set the scene, they were in a large room with a huge conference table, with Charlie at one end with a microphone in front of him and the Arab prince at the other end. In the course of the discussions, the prince made the statement, "General Brown, I think you're asking way too much for these old tanks." And that didn't suit Charlie too well. And unknown to Charlie at that moment was that his microphone was still on. and his voice echoed quite loudly across the room when he leaned over to his executive officer and said, "Jim, how do you say screw you in Farsi?" And that was Charlie Brown. Charlie didn't flinch, and the Prince paid the price for the tanks. So on behalf of my mother, Sherry, and my sister, Christy, we humbly accept this honor on behalf of Charlie Brown, the Cowboy General. Good night.
Here to present the next Western Heritage Awards in the literary category, please welcome Wrangler winner, American cowboy poet, and musician, Waddy Mitchell.
Howdy. I'd be remiss tonight if I didn't tell you ladies, you dress up nice. You look great tonight. And you gentlemen, you dress up. Dubbed the Prairie Wolf by explorer William Clark, the coyote was in fact a distinct species that captured the imagination of many Native Americans, but was otherwise viewed as unsavory. Sponsored by Chris and Mike Nicola, the Outstanding Magazine Award goes to Western historian Don Flores for his article, Coyote, an American Original. Publisher David Lautenborn, and from the Wild West Magazine and Wider History Group.
It's a tremendous honor to win a Wrangler, and I want to thank the museum. I want to thank Wild West Magazine, too, for publishing this piece. By the way, you can look at this article and others in that magazine at wildwestmagazine.com. I also want to thank my fiance, Dr. Sarah Dant, I should say, who helped me work on this piece. The piece, by the way, is actually it was part of a book proposal that sold in New York last spring. It'll be out in 2016. It's called Coyote America. And let me just say a couple of words about it before I step down. It's no accident that coyotes are the longest standing, oldest deity in North America. Native people have honored coyotes for more than 10,000 years, and there's a reason for it. It's because they so perfectly capture human nature, and one of the things I've done in this article and in the book is to try to describe the relationship between coyotes and us, especially Americans, because the coyote's penchant for expanding its range and for surviving everything we can throw at it so perfectly captures the American spirit. And in closing, I want to say this. The next time you hear a coyote howl, and everybody in here gets to do that, throw your head back and join in, because what you're hearing is the original Star Spangled Banner. Thank you very much.
Okay, you saw me foul up last time. I broke my glasses about 5 minutes ago. Less than 30 years after Lewis and Clark completed their epic journey, Prince Maximilian of Wide, a German naturalist and naturalist, I can't see diddly. And his entourage set off on their own daring expedition across North America. Accompanying the prince on this 1800s voyage was a Swiss artist named Carl Bodmer. His drawings and watercolors were just designed to illustrate journals, but now rank among the great treasures of the 19th century American art. This year's outstanding art book, sponsored by Barbara and Roger Simons, compares Bodmer's landscape images with modern-day photographs of the same views, allowing readers to see what has changed and what seems unchanged. Carl Bodmer's America Revisited, Landscapes, Views Across Time, is once a tribute to the achievements of a premier landscape artist and a photographer who followed in his footsteps. Accepting the Wrangler tonight for Outstanding Art Book are co-authors W. Raymond Wood, Robert Lindholm, and Charles Rankin from the University of Oklahoma Press.
It's been a real honor to have worked with the outstanding early Western artist, Carl Bodmer. And I might add, with an Ansel Adams Award photographer and my co-author, Robert Lindholm. This has been a labor of love, occupying nearly a quarter of a century of travel, research, and landscape photography on the part of my co-author. We're both grateful to Chuck Rankin and the University of Oklahoma Press for having faith in our work and in delivering such a beautiful book. Thank you very much.
On behalf of the staff of the University of Oklahoma Press, thank you to the, I always think of it as the Cowboy Hall of Fame. I can't get away from that. And to the judges, of course, and to Bob Lindholm and Ray Wood, who were just marvelous authors, and to that 23-year-old artist who accompanied Maximilian up the Missouri River in 1832. Thank you very much.
Back to the teleprompter. I feel like Obama up here. if they just put one big one in the back of the room where that picture is, we just stand here and grin. Named in honor of the founder of this museum, we recognize an individual for his promotion of the ideals of individualism. You can't laugh because my microphone's picking it up here. Honesty, humility, and integrity, the same ideals closely identified with American West. Here to present the Chester A. Reynolds Award, sponsored by Aline and John Goodman, is members of the board of directors, a rancher from Cimarron, New Mexico, and an inductee in the Hall of Great Westerners, Linda Davis.
Thank you. Thank you, all of you. Thank you all for being here tonight for this very, very special evening. Tonight, we recognize a leader of the Great West who shares the characteristics exemplified by Chester Reynolds. The Chester Reynolds Award, I've got to put the specs on here. Is presented to a living honoree who has exemplified the ideals of individualism, honesty, humility, and integrity of the American West. Let's take a look at this year's honoree.
B. Byron Price has distinguished himself as a writer, historian, teacher, book and art collector, publisher, past museum director, and a man with a genuine love for the American West. His friends have said that his reputation is legend, and he represents the code of the West in its finest moment. This code began as he was born and raised in Lubbock, Texas, where his family owned a Western wear and saddlery business. He left West Texas to attend the U.S. Military Academy at West Point. He spent several years as an infantry officer in the Army before returning to Texas Tech University for a master's degree in museum science. It was after graduating from Texas Tech when he nurtured and cultivated his passion of Western heritage and art as the executive director of three major Western museums, including the Panhandle Plains Historical Museum, Buffalo Bill Historical Center, and 9 years at the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum beginning in 1987. Today, that passion continues as the director of the Charles M. Russell Center for the Study of Art of the American West at the University of Oklahoma. Since 2007, he's also served as the director of the University of Oklahoma Press. He's the author of several books and numerous articles on the history and art of the American West. His work has received many awards, including several Western Heritage Awards. As the person behind the pages, he received the Joan Patterson Kerr Award from the Western History Association and the Lifetime Achievement Award from the National Cowboy Symposium. He's a man that truly embodies integrity, spirit, humanity, and character. Just like Chester Reynolds, B. Byron Price has left his handprint on this museum and the many lives he touches through his study, preservation, and sharing of the great American West.
For his unwavering commitment to Western ideals and values, please join me in congratulating the recipient of the Chester A. Reynolds Award, B. Byron Price.
Sit down. I'm both honored and humbled to receive the Chester Reynolds Award. I want to thank Linda for her kind introduction and the museum's board for bestowing this honor on me. Many people deserve to share in this accolade, only some of whom are here tonight. My late parents, Bill and Betty Price. My dad said I was raised not jerked up, provided me with every opportunity to succeed in life, and I'll always be grateful for their loving guidance. My wife Jeannie has been my rock for more than 30 years, and yeah, she was a good looking one in the pictures. She deserves a lot of credit for any success I've enjoyed, and I also want to thank our children, Roxanne and Danny, and our grandkids, Megan and Tanner, for their support. For my brother, Troy, and his wife, Connie, and my niece, Brooke, for making the effort to be here tonight. I appreciate that. I want to thank Wally Johnson, my dear friend from Cody, Wyoming, who's not here, but who was responsible for nominating me for this honor, and I thank him. In the audience, I see so many whose friendship has meant so much to me over the years. Andy Wilkinson, one of my oldest childhood pals, is honored tonight with the Wrangler, and we've come a long way since Atkins Junior High, Lubbock, Texas. Present, too, are friends from my days at the Panhandle Plains Historical Museum in Canyon, Texas, the National Cowboy Hall of Fame, which it was when I was here, and those with whom I currently work at the University of Oklahoma Press, the Charles M. Russell Center for the Study of Art of the American West, the University's School of Art and Art History, the Weizenhofer College of Fine Arts, all at the University of Oklahoma. I thank you all for coming, and thank you all for this honor. I'm humbled.
presenting the final two Western Heritage Awards in the literary category, please welcome Grammy Award-winning singer Lynn Anderson and actor Barry Corbin.
Hi there. Wow, it is good to be back here.
Hello, Lynn.
Hello, darling.
That is some good grub, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was.
I'm used to biscuits and beans. I'm not used to that good, rich food. I might have nightmares tonight.
Well, they had a red one and a white one on the same plate.
So they sure good. Did, but it was all good.
Well, since he first dreamed of a career in photography, Guy Gillette traveled regularly to his wife's ranch outside of Crockett, Texas. While Gillette first came to the Porter Place, as the ranch is known, he began to photograph the Porter family and their land. Thanks to his sense of composition, these black and white photographs dating from the 1940s led to his career as a magazine photographer.
Yes, here, collected for the first time, they document small town life in East Texas. Where Guy Gillette's son, the musical duo, the Gillette brothers, Guy and Pip, and run cattle out there. Now I got to share a little something with you here. This is not on this script, but Guy Gillette, the father, and Guy Gillette, the son, we lost them both last year. But they did live long enough to see this book finished. I wish they'd been here tonight to see it honored. Anyway, A Family of the Land offers a look at community over half a century.
Sponsored by Ray and Jerry Winchester, the Wrangler for Outstanding Photography book goes to A Family of the Land, the Texas Photography of Guy Gillette. Can I run my fingers through your hair?
Oh, yeah. It might make it grow.
This book is authored by Andy Wilkinson and the University of Oklahoma Press. Here you go.
Let me start off script like Barry. You know, I wrote a play for Barry, and I'm the first person to realize that I write it and he rewrites it every night. So I'm going to rewrite my script by saying one of the best things about tonight is getting to follow my dear friend Byron Price, whom I always hope to follow. But I owe thanks to several folks for this award. Guy Gillette, first, for his brilliant photography. His sons, Guy Porter Gillette and Pip Gillette, for introducing me to their father's work and for much help in researching their communities and their families' histories. I'm so happy that the book came out in time for both Guy and Guy Porter to see it and hold it and read it before their untimely passings. To Byron Price and Chuck Rankin of Oklahoma University Press for believing that I was the right person to write this story. For their entire staff, who were delightful to work with, and in particular, Julie Rushing, who not only designed a beautiful book, but whose design also gave me the opportunity to write with both freedom and focus. And of course, to all of you here tonight, who support what we do to honor the American West through our arts. Thank you all.
Thank you again to the museum and to the judges and to Andy Wilkinson, one of the nicest authors I've ever had the pleasure to work with. And this ad lib, congratulations, Byron.
Our final award in the literary category category is for Outstanding Poetry Book. It's sponsored by Sylvia and Bob Slater.
That's right.
This year's poetry book compiles a collection of full, glorious color prints of cowboy and western art and cowboy poems.
Brushstrokes and Balladeers takes home this year's Western Heritage Award for Outstanding Poetry Book. Accepting the award is editor Caroline Joy C.J. Hadley, my new favorite girlfriend. I can love you both. She's of Range Conservator Conservation Foundation and Range Magazine. Please welcome her.
I was here at the hall in 1983 when it was a splendid place, but a heck of a lot smaller, when Harry Webb received a Wrangler for his lifetime contribution to the Western heritage. Harry was born in 1887. He used to ride Bronx for Buffalo Bill. He was the only real cowboy in many of the old-time silent moving picture shows, and he trapped predators and trained horses for the U.S. government during World War I. Then Harry started a ranch in Nevada, and he wrote more than 100 stories about his life as a cowboy, and he called that good, bad, and plain hell. I published many of those in a book called Call of the Cow Country, because he taught me real cowboys from dudes. Harry wrote for my magazine, and he wouldn't let anyone else introduce him at the hall, so the Oklahoma, good people of Oklahoma, had to bring me in from Nevada. And I gave Harry Charlie Russell's bronze of the cowboy, as Kirk Douglas and Dennis Weaver looked on. Now in that audience, and I could see every face at the time in 1983, was Burl Ives, and he was in the middle of that audience. And after about 20-minute speech by Harry Webb, Harry got a standing ovation. And as the applause was diminishing, which took a long time, Burl Ives came straight up to me. He put my face in his hands. He kissed me on the lips, and he says, "You really know what you're doing." Well, the hall has just agreed with Burl Ives, and he's giving me thanks to 29 painters, 51 poets, and Waddy Mitchell, by the way, is on the cover. John Bardwell and Carolyn Duffarina and Terry Sullivan, a beautiful wrangler, much like Harry's. Brushstrokes and Balladeers, Painters and Poets of the American West is something to cuddle, just like Burl Ives and Barry Corbin. This is an extraordinary honor. I've been working like a dog since I was 13, and this is the treat of my life. And I think I am, as I say, more than pleased, and I pretty much, you can bet your hats that so are Harry and Burl. Thank you.
Tonight we've met and inducted three great Westerners who have made their mark preserving history and heritage. Next we meet three actors that translate their talents on the film and television. Here to make our first induction, please welcome Museum Board Member, Chairman of the Western Heritage Awards, producer and actor Wyatt McCrae, and producer and two-time Wrangler Award winner Lincoln Laugesen.
We having fun yet? Come on. Our next honor goes to a lady who worked with my grandfather on several occasions, including her Academy Award nominated performance in The More the Merrier.
Let's take a look at our first inductee into the Hall of Great Western Performers.
Jean Arthur was born Gladys Georgiana Green in 1900. And was discovered by Fox Film Studios while modeling in a commercial in New York City in the 1920s. She landed a one-year contract and debuted in the silent film Cameo Kirby. she quickly took her stage name from two of her greatest heroes, Joan of Arc and King Arthur. One day, she showed up at the Action Pictures lot, which produced Westerns, and impressed the owner, who swiftly cast her in more than 20 Westerns over a two-year period, at the time receiving only $25 a picture. These Westerns included roles in The Drugstore Cowboy, The Iron Horse, and The Hurricane Horseman. She's best remembered for films that championed the everyday heroine, and her feature roles in Mr. Deeds Goes to Town, You Can't Take It With You, and Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. Mr. Deeds was critically acclaimed and propelled her to international stardom. With fame also came media attention, something Arthur dreadfully hated, according to her colleagues, and something she battled her entire career.
Talk's cheap, you loudmouth liar.
She remained Columbia Pictures' top star until mid-1940s, when she left the studio, but not before being nominated for an Academy Award for Best Actress in 1944 for her performance in The More the Merrier. For the next several years, she turned down virtually all film offers, except to portray a homesteader's wife in the classic 1953 Western, Shane. This would be her final film, and the only film in which she would appear in color. After completing roles in more than 100 films, she went into retirement for 12 years before returning to show business in an episode of Gunsmoke. She went on to teach drama at Vassar College and North Carolina School of Arts. She advised her students, "I wish people knew how to be people, as well as that tree knows how to be a tree." For her many contributions to the Western motion picture genre, Jean Arthur has a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, and her legacy continues by being inducted into the Hall of Great Western Performers.
Upon her death, film reviewer Charles Champlin said, "To at least one teenager in a small town, though I'm sure there were a multitude, Jean Arthur suggested strongly that the ideal woman could be, ought to be, judged by her spirit as well as her beauty. The notion of a woman as a friend and confidant, as well as someone you courted and were nuts about, someone whose true beauty was internal rather than external, became a full-blown possibility as we watched Jean Arthur."
Tonight, we celebrate the many achievements of Jean Arthur as we memorialize her contributions to Western motion pictures. On behalf of the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum, it's with great pride that Wyatt and I acknowledge our newest member in the Hall of Great Western Performers, Miss Jean Arthur.
Here to recognize two Western Heritage Awards in film and television is actor Brad Johnson.
Thank you. I'd like to say hi to my five beautiful dates tonight. Rachel, Ellie, Eden, Annabeth, Rebecca, would you please stand up? Those are the Johnson girls. I'm proud of you. Sponsored by the Harrison Orr Air Conditioning, this year's outstanding documentary has undertaken the challenge of examining the changes in the horse racing industry. They take a long look at the power and beauty behind the greatest athlete in the world, the racehorse. And ultimately, we discover many secrets of both the dynasty and the state of the sport of kings. With narration and overview from Academy Award-winning actor Joe Pesci, the excitement and passion of the sport are showcased in a way never before caught on film. Congratulations to outstanding documentary, Behind the Gate, and executive producers Mark Giardino and Daryl and Lindley Giardino.
Humbled and overwhelmed to be standing here in front of you tonight winning this handsome Wrangler. You have no idea just how much this means to me and how much it touches my heart. Little did I know that 31 years ago, when my father Slim Pickens and Ben Johnson were put in as Western performers, and I unveiled the portrait with Ben because my dad was ill and couldn't be here, that I would be standing here tonight winning a Wrangler. I do have my dad's Wrangler from 1971 for the Cowboys on our mantle. And now this handsome guy will go on the mantle with Dad's. I know Dad is looking down on us tonight, and there is a big smile on his face and a twinkle in his eye and pride in his heart. He always told me, you can do anything you set your mind to. I can also hear my mother's words to my dad that night when he and Ben went into the hall together. For God's sake, Slim, be brief. And I have the same problem that Dad did. It's hard for me to be brief, but I'm trying. I do want to thank my husband, Mark, for taking this ride with me. When he stepped into this family, he had no idea what he was in for. I hope that you all get a chance to see Behind the Gate. It is a labor of love in so many ways, and it sure feels good to be back here with my roots again. You can never take the cowgirl out of the girl. Thank you all so much.
Next, we recognize the winner of the Outstanding Fictional Drama, sponsored by Monty Carroll and Burt Madeira. One Less Mule is the sixth episode of the third season of the AMC series Hell on Wheels. This American period drama television series is set during the building of the Transcontinental Railroad. Hell on Wheels, One Less Mule, written and produced by John Worth and directed by David Straighten, takes home the honors of this year's award for Outstanding Fictional Drama.
Good evening. As executive producer and senior writer for the show, I just wanted to thank Mr. Dodson, Mr. Benham, Mr. McRae, and the jury for this outstanding award. I'll take this over an Oscar and an Emmy any day. We're lucky tonight to have two of our stars with us. Jennifer Farron, who plays Louise Ellison. And one of the all-time amazingly great villains of TV, Chris Heyerdahl. My name is Mark Richard. I'm from Lake Charles, Louisiana. That's the other LA. I grew up, one side of my family was Cajun cowboy, and the other side was Coushatta Indian, so there, that explains a lot of the drama in my kitchen growing up. Excuse me. Our show has cowboys and Indians, we have Irish immigrants, we have freed slaves, we have Civil War veterans, they're all building the railroad. It's all against the backdrop of greedy politicians, intrusive federal government, and it feels like it's the front pages of the Washington Post. Let me tell you, it kind of started here, 1868. But the railroad was completed, which was the moon project of that time. And I was just inspired by something I saw today. It's the Oklahoma State motto, labor omnia vincit, hard work conquers all things. And I thought, you know what? Yes, hard work built that railroad. The Western heritage is the American heritage, and hard work can conquer all things. And I'm proud to be an American, and I'm still proud to be in a place where American works despite the Washington Post. And I'm proud to be here in the greatest country on the planet. Thank you. Having said that, I want to introduce Chad Oakes as a Canadian.
Anyway, it's a great honor to be here. I was here 7 years ago for Broken Trail with Robert Duvall with the same network I have to thank tonight, which is AMC, one of the few networks out there that still believe in this genre. So we're very happy to be here. I'd like to thank our partners at E1, our studio in Endemol, and the people behind me and with me here are the reason why this thing is so creative. John Wirth, our fearless leader and showrunner, executive producer, of course, Mark Richard, our wonderful cast, David Strayton, our director, Paul Curta, Jamie O'Brien. It's we get up at 5 o'clock every morning. We get to drive 45 minutes outside of Calgary, and it's just beautiful, gorgeous, well, torrential downpour, maybe a little bit of rain, a little bit of snow, a little bit of sleet, but we get to do something we love. I was speaking to Robert Duvall a couple days ago and told him about this, and he was like, congratulations. He says, you keep it alive. He told me a quote that he always said on Broken Trail. He said, the Russians have Chekhov, the Brits, they have William Shakespeare, but us Americans and Canadians, we have the Western. We own this. So thank you very much.
Now, please welcome actor James Drury.
For 9 seasons, I got to saddle up with a fellow cowboy as we took to living rooms weekly in the Virginian. That cowboy was Doug McClure. It is an honor and a privilege to be chosen to present this award to him tonight. When he walked into a room, he lifted everyone's spirits and put a smile on every face. We went from acquaintances to friends to best friends to lifelong blood brothers in the blink of an eye. In everything he undertook, he was successful. I miss him every day, and I feel his spirit always. So smile for him, as tonight he is inducted into the Hall of Great Western Performers. Let's take a look at this great Western performer.
Doug McClure had blonde hair, good looks, and an easy, ready smile. He was a natural man of the West, enlivening our television sets with his beloved Westerns. The athletic California native spent his youth surfing and learning to ride and rope on nearby ranches. The latter skills would eventually pay off in his many roles in several great American Westerns. Doug was discovered while surfing, and his first movie role was in The Enemy Below. His acting career included such films as The Unforgiven, Shenandoah, and South Pacific, before landing his most notable role as the cowboy Trampas during the entire run from 1962 to 1971. Of the NBC Western television series, The Virginian. He also starred in other television Westerns, including as Frank Flip Flippin on NBC's Western Overland Trail.
What's that up there?
That's the bridge.
Is there enough room for all these horses on that bridge?
Let's not tell them, huh?
He battled cancer in the final years of his life. Despite this, he continued working, appearing in The Maverick, as well as Riders in the Storm. Doug McClure's film and television career expands more than 40 years. Doug was also a very gifted sketch and watercolor artist. His Western-themed paintings are fast becoming collector's items. In 1994, Doug made his final appearance at the unveiling of his star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. Tonight, we honor Doug McClure with induction into the Hall of Great Western Performers.
Accepting the award is his daughter and actress, Tawny McClure Ahrens, daughter Valerie McClure, granddaughter Kayla McClure Ahrens, and wife Diane McClure.
Thank you.
tell you this. Thank you so much. This is...
I'm Valerie McClure.
Valerie McClure, and I'm Tawny McClure, Doug's daughter, and this is my lovely daughter, Kayla McClure Arntz, his granddaughter. We are honored to be here to accept this prestigious award on behalf of our late father, Doug McClure, and know that he would be humbled by this amazing recognition of his work in the Western genre, and know that he, with his smile, that beautiful, contagious smile that he had, was so well known for, he would be definitely beaming it now. We are excited to have our dearest friend and colleague, James Drury, here to present this beautiful award for us. Thank you. Thank you, James.
Our father was, in fact, a true cowboy, and as a child and teenager, he worked at Will Rogers Ranch, in the Pacific Palisades, and he also worked as a cattle ranch, I'm a little nervous, in Nevada as a buckaroo. He participated in many celebrity team ropings and pennings with Ben Johnson and other prominent cowboy actors, and received numerous elaborate belt buckles. It's been 19 years since our father's passing. We miss him terribly, and he's in our thoughts daily. Thank you, everybody, so much.
Thank you. Thank you to the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum, and especially to our father's fans. Thank you so much for keeping our father's memory alive. It means so much to us. Thank you. God bless. Thank you.
Presenting the final two Wrangler Awards in film and television is actor and Western Heritage Award winner, Eddie Spears.
This year's outstanding theatrical motion picture, sponsored by Mary Ann and Ken Ferguson, tells the story of the work that led Wilma Mankiller to become the first modern female chief of the Cherokee Nation. The movie is inspired by the true story of the struggle for, opposition to, and the ultimate success of a rural Cherokee community to bring running water to their families. Set in the early 1980s, the film begins in the homes of a rural Oklahoma community where many houses lack running water. Based on the true story of the Bell Waterline Project, this movie is about a community coming together to improve its life condition by building nearly 20 miles of waterline using volunteers. In the process, they inspired trust and reawakened universal indigenous values. The successful completion of the waterline sparked a movement of similar self-help projects across the Cherokee Nation and Indian Country that continues to this day. The award for Outstanding Theatrical Motion Picture is the Cherokee word for water.
You didn't know I was going to bring the whole tribe. But anyway, it's an honor to be here among great people. I want to thank my wife, Wilma Mankiller, unfortunately passed away 4 years ago, and who, if it wasn't for her, this film would not be possible. So I want to thank Christina Keel for whose idea it was to make the film. Thank my family here in the home, Oklahoma Film Commission, National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum, all the actors and the people that worked on the film and made it possible. Special thanks also goes to Bill and Lynn White. Thank the many people who contributed money for making this film, and we all accept this Wrangler Award on behalf of all Native people, Oklahomans and Americans. Thank you.
Gold, an obsession of men and nations, a symbol of wealth and power. But for the people laying Marlin mines in Guatemala Highlands, gold represents oppression, intimidation, pollution, and even murder. This year's outstanding docudrama examines the destruction and exploitation of transnational mining. With the rising price of gold, the mine's owner, Goldcorp, post record profits, while the community members live in resistance to the mine's unstoppable hunger as they protect their ancestral land. Gold Fever is recognized as this year's Western Heritage Award winner for outstanding docudrama. We close with what has to be regarded as a special night in the history of our Hall of Fame inductions. Here to present our final inductee into the Hall of Great Western Performers, please welcome back Barry Corbin.
Well, the induction of this next individual is very special to me. I've known this lady for several years, and I met her the first time on a movie called Murder in Texas. And I was playing the prosecuting attorney, and I had to question her on the stand and be mean to her. But the director told me not to look at her, to look right into the lens. Well, you know, if you look right into the lens of a camera, it's like looking in a mirror. Well, I don't shave every day because I can't bear to look in the mirror that often. And to do a scene where I'm looking into the mirror and Catherine Ross is sitting behind there, do you guys think that you could do that? No, I couldn't. Every time she talked, I'd go, and then I'd go back to looking in the mirror. And I kind of fell in love with her right then. And then later on, I worked with her and Sam on a movie called Conniger, and had to learn how to drive a stagecoach, a six-up, in 2 days because there was no place for a blind driver. Well, I'd driven 2 horses before, but I'd never driven more than 2. And it's a little different. It's kind of like asking a guy that rides a motorcycle to get in a semi-truck and back it up and turn it around and so forth. But anyhow, I played a stagecoach driver who fell in love with this lady because he loved the way she cooked biscuits. Well, I had other things in mind. But I was afraid of Sam. You know, he never lost a fight. So because of my cowardice, I never even made an attempt. I just went along and anyway, I want you to look at this footage here because it's going to, she's got the greatest biography that of anybody that I know of. So watch these clips and enjoy it.
Born in Hollywood and a keen horse rider in her youth, Catherine Ross began her acting career as an apprentice at the San Francisco Actors Workshop, which eventually led to guest starring roles in many of the popular television series of that time. Ross appeared in episodes of The Virginian, Gunsmoke, Wagon Train, and The Wild Wild West.
Her role in Gunsmoke led to co-starring with Jimmy Stewart in her first feature film, Shenandoah. She starred in two of the most popular films of the late 1960s, The Graduate, for which she won a Golden Globe Award as New Star of the Year, and an Academy Award nomination for Best Supporting Actress. She took on the role as Etta Place in Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, starring with Robert Redford and the late Paul Newman, for which she won a British Academy Film and Television Arts Award for Best Actress. She also starred in The Stepford Wives in 1975 and won another Golden Globe for Voyage of the Damned in 1976. She starred in several television movies through the early 1980s, including Rodeo Girl and the film The Legacy, where she met her husband, Sam Elliott. Her work in the industry sometimes became a labor of love, and the made-for-television movie Conniger was a perfect example of this. Besides starring as the strong Western character Mrs. Evie Teal, Catherine and her husband Sam, along with Jeffrey M. Meyer, worked together to adapt the screenplay of this beloved Louis L'Amour novel. A decorated Hollywood star, Catherine Ross now takes her place in the Hall of Great Western Performers.
Please join me in welcoming to the Hall of the Great Western Performers inductee, my friend Catherine Ross.
Thank you very much. The Western is our heritage. I mean, it is the American genre. I'm very proud and honored to be inducted into this incredible museum and Cowboy Hall of Fame. I don't even know what to say. It's a very emotional and moving moment. Doug McClure, I was in the first movie that I was in, Shenandoah. I pay homage to his family, and I'm so glad that he's here. Jean Arthur was in my favorite movie when I was growing up, which was Shane. I didn't know it was her last movie. It's indeed incredible to be here. Thank you for your generous greeting. And I hope they make more Westerns. They gotta make good ones, though. Thank you.
How about that? Congratulations, Catherine. With your induction tonight, you and Sam join Roy Rogers and Dale Evans as the only other husband and wife enshrined in the Hall of Great Western Performers. That's something to be proud of. Come on. Congratulations to all tonight's Western Heritage Award winners, inductees, and special thanks to you, to our presenters, sponsors, and special guests who made this night possible. Let's give it up, come on. Believe it or not, this concludes the 53rd anniversary of the Western Heritage Awards. Have a great night and say, yee-haw! Yee-haw!